there are no African specific beauty products. If those in the diaspora were to make a deliberate effort that you are going to market those in Europe and America, or rather in Africa, from Europe and America, our sons and daughters who are resident there, then Agenda 2063 would be given its significance. Lastly, African Union is now beginning to recognize that the diaspora is important. One of the things that I hope you'll be requesting sooner rather than later is to have observer status at the AU, so that you are able to articulate these things. If you get it, and the reason why I think that is achievable, there is not a single African country, and if there is, you'll tell me which one, which does not deliberately have an office in their embassies in Europe, America, and in other parts of the world that deal with the diaspora issues. The Washoe has talked about their circle here. I'm sure that the Kenyan embassy in Washington is now coming and is willing to help you, because they recognize that foreign remittances from outside is a very important component of the economy. I think in Nigeria, it is the second highest foreign exchange earner. So Agenda 2063 is something that we ought to articulate, and if we do articulate it well and implement, then its dividends will be realized. And thank you.
Thank you. I think it's time to sit down here. We have China. The next question. We have about four questions about China. All of them are asking particularly the influence that China is having on the continent. Why?
Let me, first of all, without claiming any expertise, there is something to admire about China. All of us will remember the activities of Tiananmen Square. That was the 1980s. Tiananmen Square was a defining moment for China, when China was moving in the direction of liberalizing our economy and doing so in a manner that was slow and deliberate. What the Chinese did, in my view, from which we can learn, is that they defined themselves, which is what we were talking about a little earlier, that each civilization must define ourselves. The Chinese made a decision that we have a population of 1.5 billion. There are certain things that stand in our way, and there are certain things that we can ask. Number one, we can no longer afford the luxury of having a large population. Therefore, they introduced the one-child policy. Number two, we've got to ensure that our economy is protected from unnecessary competition until we have the capacity to compete. Therefore, they closed their banking industry. Therefore, they shut down the insurance sector. Therefore, they did not allow their yuan to float. Therefore, they were very careful when they were negotiating under the WTO rules. Therefore, they were very careful how they allowed rice to get into their economy. Therefore, they engaged in deliberate exercise of sending their young men and women to Europe and to the United States, and they came here with specific agenda. You go into engineering, you go into technology, you go into this sector. Then they engaged in reverse engineering in many of these things, so that they went to Germany and they got things that were made by Siemens, and they reverse engineered. Today, the Chinese are in every sector. You remember, until very recently in the 80s and the 90s, the leading mobile companies, the thing that you and me wanted to buy was BlackBerry. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was Nokia. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was Samsung. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was iPhone. 20 years later, out of 9, 10 mobile telephones is either Tecno or Huawei or some other phone or Infinix. In the next 10 years, I think out of every 10 telephones that we are using is either put together in China or made by the Chinese. If you go into the lift industry, the elevator industry, what we call lift, those of us who are trained by the English, they're now in that sector. In the jet industry, we now know that they have already tested their own medium-sized jets. So you are dealing with the people who define what they want. They have now gone into the mining sector. And if those in the diaspora were to make a deliberate effort that you are going to market those in Europe and America, or rather in Africa, from Europe and America, our sons and daughters who are resident there, then Agenda 2063 would be given its significance. Lastly, African Union is now beginning to recognize that the diaspora is important. One of the things that I hope you'll be requesting sooner rather than later is to have observer status at the AU, so that you are able to articulate these things. If you get it, and the reason why I think that is achievable, there is not a single African country, and if there is, you'll tell me which one, which does not deliberately have an office in their embassies in Europe, America, and in other parts of the world that deal with the diaspora issues. The Washoe has talked about their circle here. I'm sure that the Kenyan embassy in Washington is now coming and is willing to help you, because they recognize that foreign remittances from outside is a very important component of the economy. I think in Nigeria, it is the second highest foreign exchange earner. So Agenda 2063 is something that we ought to articulate, and if we do articulate it well and implement, then its dividends will be realized. And thank you.
Thank you. I think it's time to sit down here, brother. We have China. The next question. We have about four questions about China. All of them are asking particularly the influence that China is having on the continent.
Let me, first of all, without claiming any expertise, there is something to admire about China. All of us will remember the activities of Tiananmen Square. That was the 1980s. Tiananmen Square was a defining moment for China, when China was moving in the direction of liberalizing her economy and doing so in a manner that was slow and deliberate. What the Chinese did, in my view, from which we can learn, is that they defined themselves, which is what we were talking about a little earlier, that each civilization must define herself. The Chinese made a decision that we have a population of 1.5 billion. There are certain things that stand in our way, and there are certain things that weaken us. Number one, we can no longer afford the luxury of having a large population. Therefore, they introduced the one-child policy. Number two, we've got to ensure that our economy is protected from unnecessary competition until we have the capacity to compete. Therefore, they closed their banking industry. Therefore, they shut down the insurance sector. Therefore, they did not allow their yuan to float. Therefore, they were very careful when they were negotiating under the WTO rules. Therefore, they were very careful how they allowed rice to get into their economy. Therefore, they engaged in deliberate exercise of sending their young men and women to Europe and to the United States, and they came here with specific agenda. You go into engineering, you go into technology, you go into this sector. Then they engaged in reverse engineering in many of these things, so that they went to Germany and they got things that were made by Siemens, and they reverse engineered. Today, the Chinese are in every sector. You remember, until very recently in the 80s and the 90s, the leading mobile companies, the thing that you and me wanted to buy was BlackBerry. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was Nokia. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was Samsung. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was iPhone. 20 years later, out of 9-10 mobile telephones is either Tecno or Huawei or some other phone or Infinix. In the next 10 years, I think out of every 10 telephones that we are using is either put together in China or made by the Chinese. If you go into the lift industry, the elevator industry, what we call lift, those of us who are trained by the English, they're now in that sector. In the jet industry, we now know that they have already tested their own medium-sized jets. So you are dealing with the people who define what they want. They have now gone into the mining sector. And we now know that in the mining sector, they are mandatory element about other things. And there are no African-specific beauty products. If those in the diaspora were to make a deliberate effort that you are going to market those in Europe and America, or rather in Africa, from Europe and America, our sons and daughters who are resident there, then Agenda 2063 would be given its significance. Lastly, African Union is now beginning to recognize that the diaspora is important. One of the things that I hope you will be requesting sooner rather than later is to have observer status at the AU, so that you are able to articulate these things. If you get it, and the reason why I think that is achievable, there is not a single African country, and if there is, you'll tell me which one, which does not deliberately have an office in their embassies in Europe, America, and in other parts of the world that deal with the diaspora issues. The Washoe has talked about their circle here. I'm sure that the Kenyan embassy in Washington is now coming and is willing to help you, because they recognize that foreign remittances from outside is a very important component of the economy. I think in Nigeria, it is the second highest foreign exchange earner. So Agenda 2063 is something that we ought to articulate, and if we do articulate it well and implement, then its dividends will be realized. And thank you.
Thank you. I think it's time to sit down here, brother. We have China. The next question. We have about four questions about China. All of them are asking particularly the influence that China is having on the continent.
Let me, first of all, without claiming any expertise, there is something to admire about China. All of us will remember the activities of Tiananmen Square. That was the 1980s. Tiananmen Square was a defining moment for China, when China was moving in the direction of liberalizing our economy and doing so in a manner that was slow and deliberate. What the Chinese did, in my view, from which we can learn, is that they defined themselves, which is what we were talking about a little earlier, that each civilization must define herself. The Chinese made a decision that we have a population of 1.5 billion. There are certain things that stand in our way, and there are certain things that we can ask. Number one, we can no longer afford the luxury of having a large population. Therefore, they introduced the one-child policy. Number two, we've got to ensure that our economy is protected from unnecessary competition until we have the capacity to compete. Therefore, they closed their banking industry. Therefore, they shut down the insurance sector. Therefore, they did not allow their yuan to float. Therefore, they were very careful when they were negotiating under the WTO rules. Therefore, they were very careful how they allowed rice to get into their economy. Therefore, they engage in deliberate exercise of sending their young men and women to Europe and to the United States, and they came here with specific agenda. You go into engineering, you go into technology, you go into this sector. Then they engage in reverse engineering in many of these things, so that they went to Germany and they got things that were made by Siemens, and they reverse engineered. Today, the Chinese are in every sector. You remember, until very recently in the 80s and the 90s, the leading mobile companies, the thing that you and me wanted to buy was BlackBerry. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was Nokia. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was Samsung. The thing that you and me wanted to buy was iPhone. 20 years later, out of 9-10 mobile telephones is either Tecno or Huawei or some other phone or Infinix. In the next 10 years, I think out of every 10 telephones that we are using is either put together in China or made by the Chinese. If you go into the lift industry, the elevator industry, what we call lift, those of us who are trained by the English, they're now in that sector. In the jet industry, we now know that they have already tested their own medium-sized jets. So you are dealing with the people who defined what they want. They have now gone into the mining sector. And we now know that in the mining sector, there are presence in the Democratic Republic of Congo, COLTA, which is a mandatory element